Hey, stargazers, welcome back. My name is Nick. I'm a theaters manager at the Adler Planetarium, and you're watching Skywatch Weekly. Before we dive into this week's episode, I want to take a brief moment to say thank you. There are billions of galaxies in the universe, so we're saying a billion thank yous to everyone who helped Adler raise over $129,000 during our year-end fundraising campaign. That's 2.5 times more than our original goal. Special thanks this week go out to Joanne R. Potashnik, Marilyn Hirsch, Abigail Perkins, Craig and Elizabeth Hudson, Doug Adler, and Nancy and Mark McClelland. Thank you for believing in our mission, for supporting our online programs, and for continuing to help us bring space science to everyone, everywhere. Thank you. Well, winter has fully arrived here in the Northern Hemisphere, and with it, the beautiful stars of the wintertime sky. Now, this time of the year, it is tempting to stay in during the evening and, you know, stay warm. But you might find it rewarding to get out there, bundle up for sure, and stay out at least for a little bit and see the sights that can be seen. Over the next few weeks, I want to cover the wintertime constellations you can expect to see. And we're going to start this week with probably the best-known constellation, certainly the centerpiece of this wintertime sky, and that's Orion the Hunter. Tonight, Orion is pretty obvious. You almost can't miss it. It's easily seen in the eastern sky after sunset. Now, by about 5 hours after sunset, and keep in mind, that's not all that late in the night, right around 9:30 here in Chicago this month, Orion will be about halfway up in the southern sky. The easiest way to find this constellation is by looking for this line of three bright stars, known as the Belt of Orion. This asterism, or pattern of stars, is bright enough to be seen even through a lot of light pollution. Here are a couple of images I've taken here in Chicago. Here's Orion rising over the dome of the Adler Planetarium. And here's a view of Orion from an area just outside of downtown. Now, as you get farther into the suburbs, the view, of course, improves as the sky gets darker. And from a truly dark sky, like this one in the Middle Fork River Forest Preserve in Illinois, the view is much, much better. But you don't need a dark sky to spot Orion's belt and the basic outline of the constellation. All of those pictures, by the way, were taken with my smartphone. Many newer phones have an astrophotography mode that allows you to take some pretty cool pictures using just your phone. This bright star in Orion's shoulder is called Betelgeuse, a red supergiant star so huge that if it were in our solar system, it would extend out beyond the orbit of Mars. It's so big that it's one of the few stars that's been directly imaged to be more than just a point of light. This is an image from the Hubble Space Telescope showing the disk of Betelgeuse. This star is normally in the top 10 brightest stars in the sky. It varies slightly in brightness. But you might remember in late 2019, it started dimming rapidly, eventually falling out of the top 20 brightest stars over several months. Although it eventually rebrightened, scientists are still puzzling over this event. Possible explanations include sunspots or the emission of a dust cloud from Betelgeuse. Diagonal across the belt is Rigel, a blue supergiant star. The color contrast between Rigel and Betelgeuse is striking. The color of stars is based on their temperature, with cooler stars appearing orange or red, and hotter stars blue or white. Interestingly, Betelgeuse is much larger than Rigel, but about 9,000 degrees cooler. Rigel is more massive than Betelgeuse. For many people, Orion is the first constellation they learn. Along with the pattern of the Big Dipper, it's bright and recognizable from any sky. Unlike the Big Dipper, though, Orion is seasonal and can't always be seen this easily in the evening sky, only really from about December through March. It can be seen at other times of the year, but not at such reasonable hours. I've spent many a late night in August or September seeing Orion rise in the early morning hours. In April, you can still catch Orion early in the evening before it sets. But for much of May, June, and July, for mid-northern latitudes, this well-known constellation is only in the sky when the sun is up. From the southern hemisphere, things are a little bit better for spotting Orion, as the constellation is visible more easily in May and July. Oh, and keep in mind, from the southern hemisphere, Orion looks like he's doing a headstand. Speaking of different ways to see Orion, what do you see when you look at this pattern of stars? It's been interpreted in many different ways throughout time. In Sumerian astrology, this pattern was associated with Gilgamesh, the hero fighting the bull of heaven, represented by nearby Taurus. The Greeks gave us the character of Orion, holding up his unbreakable bronze club in one hand, and in the other, the skin of a lion. Ancient Egyptians associated Orion with the god Osiris. In Islamic astronomy, Orion is known simply as the giant. And Ojibwe Native Americans call this constellation the Winter Maker, as its appearance ushers in the winter season. Well, if you can stand the cold a little bit longer, there's more to be seen in this constellation, especially with some optical aid. There aren't only stars to be seen in Orion. Orion is home to probably the best-known nebula in the sky, the Orion Nebula, or M42. This huge star-forming region is 1,500 light-years away, but it's visible just barely to the naked eye as a smudge of light in the Sword of Orion, which hangs below his belt. Binoculars or small telescopes start to give an even better view of this star-forming cloud. With a backyard scope and a dark sky or nebula filter, you can start to see the enveloping cradle of dust and gas. New stars are forming from this dust and gas, and the light from these stars illuminates the nebula. The brightest of these new stars, as seen from Earth, are visible through backyard telescopes. They form this pattern called the trapezium. These four are just the most obvious of the newborn stars. Many of the others are hidden in the nebula itself. The Orion Nebula is just the most obvious part of a huge molecular cloud in the direction of the constellation Orion. With larger telescopes, or especially through astrophotography, an amazing array of objects can be seen. These include the Horsehead Nebula, a column of dust 24 trillion miles tall that's silhouetted against the brighter clouds behind. Also the nearby Flame Nebula, illuminated by the blazing Alnitak, the easternmost star of Orion's belt. And the Witch's Head Nebula, an area of dust and gas reflecting the light of brilliant Rigel. It looks uncannily like a witch staring open-mouthed at the star. Wide-angle astrophotography of the Orion constellation shows just how much gas and dust lies in this section of the Milky Way galaxy, and also how little our eyes can see, even in very dark skies. So as familiar as Orion might be, it holds a lot of surprises, and I hope you'll get out there and see it for yourself. My challenge for you this week is to brave the cold at least one evening, assuming we get a clear one, and take a look at Orion. See what you imagine up there, and let us know in the comments. Well, that's what we have for you this week. Thanks, as always, for watching. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button and also follow the Adler Planetarium on social media. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next week.